A meter is defined as the distance traveled by light in 3 billionths of a second. A second is defined as the time it takes for about 9 billion cycles of radiation of the cesium atom. But the definition of the kilogram is a little bit more approachable. It's literally the mass of this particular chunk of metal in Paris called the International Prototype Kilogram, or just IPK. And even though it's easier to understand, having an artifact as a definition comes with its own particular set of challenges. Measurements are so important to us, they have their own specific branch of science, metrology. And metrologists have come up with a pretty clever way of redefining the kilogram.
Hey, I'm Grady. Today on Practical Engineering, we're building a watt balance.
And put on your asbestos pajamas, because the last time I played with electricity, Hackaday awarded me the fail of the week. The kilogram is the only SI base unit currently defined by an artifact instead of a fundamental physical constant. But the kilo is a part of the definition of 20 other units, including 3 other base units. It shows up in the amp, the watt, the newton, the joule, the candela, the ohm, the lumen, the lux, and mole, not to mention any of the imperial units which are officially defined based on their metric equivalents. In other words, basically the entire world system of measurements can be traced back to this single object in a vault in France. And you know they give it another bell jar just to make sure it was extra safe. Here's the issue. We made lots of copies of the IPK to be used around the world, and we periodically hold kilogram reunions, so to speak, where all the facsimiles come back together for comparison. And despite our utmost diligence and care, it seems that the mass of each copy is drifting over time, gaining or losing fractions of a gram, probably due to handling and or long-term exposure to air. But one of the masses hasn't changed, the IPK. Not because it has the same mass as it started with, but because it is literally the definition of a kilogram. You can put it on one side of the scale, but there's nothing to put on the other side. But the inconvenient truth is that all its copies are changing in mass over time, so we're pretty confident that the IPK is too. The linchpin of our entire system of measurements has some wiggle room that's impossible to characterize because there's nothing more constant to compare it to. And that's bad. So scientists are working to redefine the kilogram to be based on a fundamental physical constant, and they've come up with a pretty cool way to accomplish this. The watt balance. Fundamentally, the watt balance is a scale that uses an electromagnetic force to balance the weight of the object it's measuring. But it has a trick up its sleeve that allows it to measure with extreme accuracy and precision. I built a model to help illustrate how it works. This watt balance is based on a design created by a few scientists at the US National Institute of Standards and Technology, and there's a link to their paper in the description. Their design used Legos, but I really like the juxtaposition of a precision scientific instrument made with a natural material, so I made mine out of wood. And there's a separate video all about how this was built that I'll link below so you can check it out after this. Before we reveal the secret to the watt balance's extreme precision, we need to perform the initial alignment and calibration, which is a perfect opportunity to show the different parts of the model. At first glance, the watt balance looks like a standard beam balance you'd see in a classroom or in practically any motif related to justice, but you're looking at a sophisticated scientific device capable of measuring to within an error of approximately 1%, or at least that's what the scientists said. The real watt balances have accuracies up to 2 parts in 100 million. Each of the two platforms includes a wound coil of wire. The platforms are hollow so that they can move freely up and down around a pair of opposing permanent magnets on each side. To measure the position of the arm, the watt balance uses a shadow sensor, which consists of a photodiode and a laser line. As the balance moves, it gradually obstructs the path of the laser, changing the intensity of the light hitting the sensor. Another laser on top of the arm provides an optical lever for calibration. A small movement of the arm creates a large movement of the laser dot on an adjacent wall. By measuring the distance the optical lever moves for a few different arm positions, and comparing those to the corresponding readings from the shadow sensor, we can calibrate the watt balance so it knows the precise position of its arm. Now we can start measuring. The secret to the watt balance's extreme precision is its dual mode operation, which utilizes some interesting properties of electromagnetism. In the first mode, the watt balance applies a current to one of the coils around the platform, creating an electromagnet. The coil reacts to the existing magnetic field, generating an upward force, also known as the Laplace force. This setup is similar to how many electric motors work, applying a current to a coil of wire within a magnetic field. The control software written by the NIST scientists includes a control algorithm that can do this automatically, but I'm just manually adjusting the current in the coil using my bench power supply until the upward force is exactly equal to the weight of the object. I do this once with no object, once with the object, and then once again without it to get an accurate value of just the current required to balance the object by itself. Let's take a look at this system expressed as an equation. The weight of the object is simply its mass times the gravitational acceleration of the Earth. The Laplace force is the product of the magnetic field strength of the permanent magnets, the length of the wire in the coil, and the current in the coil. If the beam is static, that means the two forces are equal. Remember, our goal is to find the mass of the object. We can measure gravity and current to a very high accuracy, but the length of the coil, and especially the magnetic field strength, are very difficult to measure with extreme accuracy. Without those values, we can't solve this equation for mass. Yet. This is where the ingenuity of the Watt balance comes into play. You may know that many electric motors can be used in reverse to generate electricity if you apply a mechanical input force. In other words, the electromagnetic principle is reversible. The Watt balance takes advantage of this for its second mode of operation. Instead of applying a current to the coil, we simply move it through the magnetic field. We know from Faraday's law of induction, when you move a conductor through a magnetic field, you generate a voltage. This is the reason our Watt balance has two coils. Applying a varying current to coil B moves the beam in an up and down motion. The shadow sensor that we calibrated earlier measures the velocity of this motion, and we also measure the voltage induced in coil A. The software samples both the voltage and velocity as the coil moves through the magnetic field. From Faraday's law, we know that voltage is equal to the product of velocity, magnetic field strength, and the length of the conductor. Remember from the first mode that we couldn't accurately measure the magnetic field strength or the precise length of the conductor, but we're using the same coil around the same pair of permanent magnets. In other words, even though we don't know what they are, we do know that these two variables are exactly the same in both equations. As the software samples the velocity and voltage, it generates a best fit line. The slope of this line represents the quantity of BL that we couldn't measure directly. With a little bit of algebra, we can rearrange these equations and perform a substitution to completely eliminate these variables. And take a look at the units. Current times voltage is power, and force times velocity is power. Both are measured in watts, hence the name of the instrument. Rearranging a bit more, now we have an equation for mass which only consists of the parameters that we're capable of measuring accurately. We measure the current required to hold up the object in the first mode. Then we measure the slope of voltage over velocity in the second mode. We know the acceleration due to Earth's gravity, so we have everything we need to determine the mass of the object. It's so simple that you almost don't notice how big of a deal this really is. Traditionally, an instrument that measures mass would be calibrated using known artifacts that themselves were calibrated using known artifacts, and so on, in a chain all the way back to the IPK. But I didn't do any of that. I know this mass is about 20 grams because it says so right on top, but if I didn't know that, and had nothing to compare it to, I could still get an accurate measurement out of the Watt balance. And here's the most important part. Since voltage and current are defined in terms of fundamental physical constants, the Watt balance makes it possible to define the kilogram in terms of these absolutes, eliminating the need for a physical artifact. Trace them back far enough and you'll find that all measurements are relative. They're a comparison. Sometimes a comparison to something immutable, but in the case of the kilogram, not yet. Redefining the kilogram to be based on a fundamental physical constant means not only that we have more confidence in our measurements, but it also makes metrology more democratic by metaphorically setting the standard free from its vault and bell jars so that anyone with a garage workshop and a little bit too much free time has access. Measurements are the language of science and engineering, and metrology makes sure that we're all speaking the same one. Thank you for watching, and let me know what you think. For me, learning something new is one of the greatest joys in life. This episode of Practical Engineering is brought to you by the Great Courses Plus, where you can get unlimited access to over 7,000 different video lectures from award-winning professors and technical experts from around the world about anything that interests you, from robotics to storytelling, foreign languages to art, and my favorite so far, this fantastic series by civil engineer Stephen Ressler, which includes 32 lectures on the engineering principles behind all kinds of everyday items in our lives. Right now, the Great Courses Plus is offering fans of Practical Engineering a free one-month trial, and trust me, you can watch a lot of videos in a month. To redeem your free subscription, please visit thegreatcoursesplus.com/practical, or you can click on the link in the description below. Again, thank you for watching, and let me know what you think.